When something is free of charge, it just means that you are the product.
Hi everyone, and welcome to GovTech Decoded, where we decode technical speak. In this series, we will discuss core tech topics and how the Singapore government leverages technologies to build tech for public good. I'm GovTechie Alicia.
I'm GovTechie Andre. And we're your hosts for today's episode.
Today, we'll continue to talk about data and AI with Andre and two new guests.
Hi everyone, I'm Ghim Eng. I lead the data practice as well as the data products team GovTech.
So I'm James, I'm a data engineer in the data practice team. I've been here for about 2 years, so it's a short time compared to everyone here. But what I do is to build central tools for everyone to use in the whole of government.
We actually covered quite a bit about data and AI in our recent episodes, from the Gen AI boom to prompt engineering. So maybe taking a step back, do you know when data and AI first came about?
Yeah, so AI actually first got popular back in the 1950s. It was when Alan Turing published a book called The Machinery and Intelligence, which proposed a test on how we can define machine intelligence. And it's called the imitation game.
Some of you may know it by the name of the Turing test instead. Actually, it's very simple. It's just designed to answer one very fundamental question. Can machines even think? Okay, back then, Alan Turing and the scientists believed that machines would never be able to attain human intelligence. So they compromised. They said, can a machine trick you to the point that you can't distinguish it from a human chatting with you over maybe a text interface? And that is what we are talking about with the Turing test. You still remember when ChatGPT was introduced to the world? When I chatted with ChatGPT, I could not even tell that it's not some human sitting in the miracles trying to answer my questions on the spot. I was too amazed. So I immediately ran to my wife out in the living room and tell her, hey, I got this new thing, right? They always ask me what I do, right? This thing will show you, like, hey, it's not a human, by the way. And she was blown away. And since then, we have been planning all our holidays using ChatGPT.
Yeah, and these days, you know, this AI thing is everywhere. I recently bought a rice cooker, and then it claims to have AI also. I don't know how it works, frankly, but you know, the rice turned out fine. So, you know.
Well, it sounds like AI has been around for like decades. So why did it suddenly get so popular overnight?
We have been introduced the concept of the internet, and we have been doing social networks for a long time, right? It's only until recently whereby people have found a way to get all this data into one place and then to learn on it, okay? So to learn on the data, you need two things. You need the data, obviously.
Yes.
Okay? And then you need the infrastructure. You need the computing powers. And in recent years, the rise of GPUs, right now it should be a common term to everybody. You used to know CPUs, right? Everybody knows CPUs, RAM. But GPUs is like a common terminology now for the industry. So until recently, researchers were not able to train on this huge amount of data because they don't have the infra. But this has changed overnight. And of course, not forgetting what I mentioned just now, the intuitiveness of the ChatGPT interface. The fact that I can whip out a phone, okay, and talk to some AI, okay, that is like hosted millions of miles away. That power is in the hand of everybody overnight. Yeah, and the rest is really history. So for the first time, AI, instead of being a scientist, tool, it has become a power tool in the hand of the common man.
So from my experience, when I shared this with my other friends and family who are non-technical, they were able to just use it with no problems. This is very different from sharing other type of technical tools. Some people will not actually get it, but for ChatGPT, everyone got it. And I think the simplicity helped ChatGPT to reach a million users within just 5 days. Just because it's so simple to use. And this rapid adoption actually caught the attention of a lot of different people and businesses. And that's why massive financial investments started pouring in into the AI space. And I think this is what has driven the incredible growth that we are seeing today on AI.
And that brings me to my next question. There is a prediction that 70% of the world's government will use AI to enhance their administrative decisions by 2026. And being the head of the data practice, Ghim Eng, what role do you think data and AI will play for the Singapore government?
Oh, glad you asked. I'm very happy to share about this. Okay, so I haven't met 100% of those government, but 100% actually said yes, they are using AI. So anecdotally, I can say that 100% of who I've met, the world leaders and the tech leaders of the government, they have recognized the importance of having the right data and having the right AI technology in place for them. So for me, I'm more down to earth, right? So as public officers, what do we do every day? We help citizens to make the right decisions. Our decisions can have huge impact. Okay, our decisions can make a difference to whether somebody gets the grant. So it's very important that we have the right data at the right time. Okay, and we use it in the right way to make the right decisions. Now, data is the fundamental for which AI models are being trained. So the right quality of this data is very important also, so that we can automate some of this complicated decision process by training the AI models and making them augment our ability to make decisions quickly.
I think data is an important enabler for decision making, like you said.
Yeah, indeed. And it may sound easy on hindsight. Everything is very easy on hindsight. Actually, it's not that easy to achieve, as I explained just now, right? The bright stars have been aligned. We need to have all the things in place. Now that we have democratized AI to the hand of the common man, right? The innovation is flourishing. So when people are excited, we also need to have the data infrastructure, like I mentioned just now. We need to be able to use these AI tools in a reliable and secure manner. So this may seem like a long time ago, but when COVID struck Singapore, right, during the nationwide contact tracing, it was only because we had the right data engineering and infrastructure in place that we could connect all our agencies and businesses and as swiftly to enable livelihoods to go on.
Whenever we think about data and AI, we always think about the cool use cases such as fraud or detecting scams. But all these use cases are not possible without the right people and the right data in the right place. And in fact, with most data and AI use cases, majority of the time is actually educating people and finding the right people for this and also settling the data infrastructure behind the scenes before you even start training the AI model.
So what are some examples of how data and AI are used in the government? Can you shed some light on this?
In my team, we use some of the central AI tools such as PairChat, which is the ChatGPT for government offices. And they use it for drafting emails, budget paper, and etc. Yeah, so that's the most basic level of how we use productivity tools within the government. But apart from simple productivity tools, we also build custom tools. And my team specifically designs and builds all these custom data and AI tools for our agencies and also our other GovTech teams. We will talk to our developers and users to find out what problems they are facing. But our goal for using these tools with everyone is that everyone get better at managing and protecting and using their data for public good. In fact, I think a more appropriate role for me is like the data enabler rather than just a normal data scientist or data engineer. We just work very closely with agencies to enable their data and AI use cases.
That's very impressive. So can you share an example about audience of how you have enabled these other agencies?
Of course. I can share more about my work in Maestro. So Maestro is a central product that provides MLOps capabilities for the whole of government. And this capability means that agencies can do faster model retraining and also deploy endpoints to other agency networks. And we help to settle the nitty-gritty things behind the scenes like security and other stuff so that you yourself, when you're using this platform, can just focus on building your own AI use cases without worrying about other things. One of our customers is actually MOM. So Ministry of Manpower actually deployed this application called MOM SenseMaker. And this SenseMaker is actually used to extract insights from large volumes of text. And this is very useful for MOM in their work because they need to manage employment, right? You can imagine they need to read through large amount of documents about employment-related things and then use this to feedback to their own policy making. So SenseMaker helps with that. And SenseMaker has estimated to save over 2,000 man hours in over just 3 months. Yeah, and it improved the user's ability to extract insights by almost 60%. So in addition to the technical MLOps capabilities, right, we also engage agencies directly and we advise them on how to do best practice for their own AI use cases and share our existing code base to help them improve or help them productionize their models even faster. And we make sure that agencies have all the help that they need to navigate the complex world of AI. So for any public officers that is listening, right, do reach out to us if you are keen on productionizing your data and AI use cases.
Put his email address.
A major part of our mission here in the center of government is to help the wider agencies leverage this cool new technology to improve the services to their citizens and businesses. Most importantly, we have to do it without compromising security. As adoption of data and AI increases across the government, my team also looks at ensuring that we scale this responsibly.
Oh, so government services like SingPass and Healthy 365?
Yeah, Those are examples, okay? But I can share more concrete examples that we are doing that are actually helping the whole government in doing this scaled. For example, we have a whole government secure data sharing platform.
Okay.
And this is not just limited to government agencies sharing data to one another. It's actually for public and private sectors to share data securely and reliably. So we play on the word trust. So the platform name is called enTRUST. So we have this secure data exchange platform that enables the public and private sector to come together in a place that guarantees that it will be used for the right purpose by the right people. And a lot of interesting research have blossomed because of this, some of which are even trying to find cures for cancers, for example. So as you can see, by combining the data from the public and private sector, these are the kind of work that actually makes me really excited, okay, and really inspired to continue working in this data AI field. Last but not least, I want to add on that our team takes data privacy very seriously. So we have a dedicated product called Cloak. Cloak, as in the thing that you build over yourself. Okay, but we choose the name because we want it to convey the sense that we need to protect personal data. And it needs to be something that we think before we use the data or share the data. We need to protect it so that when we do the sharing, for example, through the enTRUST platform, we are sure that we're not leaking information unnecessarily.
It's cool to see Singaporeans using AI to improve work and services. And in our first episode, we actually spoke about using AI in cybersecurity as well.
And our episode on tech stacks, we also touched on how AI is changing software development and how people code. But despite the rapid adoption of AI across sectors, there are people who are still skeptical and wary about AI, right? Will you tell them not to be worried, or do you have any concerns as well?
Yeah, I will actually tell them that they are absolutely right to be skeptical. It's only natural, right? It's only natural for people to be wary of things they do not understand. And AI, just like any other tool, has the inherent danger that it can be used to hurt either yourself or even other people if you do not know how to use it properly. But in today's world where data and AI is everywhere and it's so integrated in everyone's lives, right? It's something that you can't really avoid anymore, unless you move to a deserted island, lah. Yeah.
But even then, you still got internet access when people
buy you. GPS can see you, right? But yeah, to mitigate this risk, I think what we need to do is to actually improve our education and awareness of AI so that we can all be cognizant of what AI can really do. And then after that, we can fully leverage on AI's full potential.
Yeah, I agree, James. Yeah. So I myself have two young kids, okay? And I worry often about their online activities. So instead of trying to change behavior, I'm trying to make the world safer for them. Okay. So they are already exposed to AI. Okay. All the technology you spoke about just now, right? Maybe less so of the AI rice cooker, but maybe more of the ChatGPT type. Because schools are encouraging them to use those for presentations, to write their reports, or their essays. Okay. It's a fact of life. Okay. And it actually makes them better students. So I have no complaint about that. But in our line as the public officers, I would think that we have the responsibility to our citizens to deal with a magnitude of our complex factors and ethical concerns in such a way that this can actually impact lives, okay, if you're not careful. So while I agree that AI is exciting, it's a very strong enabler of innovations. I will also caution that AI is not a silver bullet to all kinds of problems. Okay, when we're dealing with human life and human beings, like you and me, okay, we really need that human touch in the really important decisions. And that is why I often refer to AI as augmented intelligence rather than the more sexy term artificial intelligence. I also offer one final precaution, okay, if I may. So there is actually a theory called no free lunch. Okay, there's no free lunch in this world. Okay. So when we use ChatGPT, when we use supposedly free services like Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, even this Xiaohongshu, all these things, right? Okay, so we may think that it's all FOC, it's free of charge, right? But actually, when something is free of charge, it just means that you are the product. You. They are learning as we interact with the tools how to target us better, more precisely, and to target the people around us, our social network, more precisely.
My personal tip for listeners is that you should never ever send your personal data to these chat services and always make use of the principle of least privilege. Only share data when you really need to. And in the most secure case, even you can host your own open source AI model on your own devices instead of using other people's online chat services. And so that your data remains on your device rather than someone else's service.
And what about ethical considerations?
For the agencies that we work with, they always have a common question to us. Whether the AI models are fair, how do we know that? How do we guarantee that the model predictions are correct and they are not actually hallucinating? So we have a team in GovTech that looks at precisely this, the guardrails for AI deployment. So we have some products, they are still in the works. They are specifically designed to detect toxicity in Singapore's context. You can imagine the most of the LLMs in the world are trained on English, yeah. Corpus. But you and me, we grew up here, we speak Singlish, right?
Mm-hmm.
All the la, all the law, okay? And then it confuses the models a lot. And then malicious players can use this as a loophole to trick the LLM to inject malicious or toxic replies, okay? And imagine this happens when you try to use a government chatbot. Okay.
No.
Yeah, it's really unthinkable. And hence, we have these teams that their full-time job is to look into this problem and see whether we can mitigate the risk of doing so.
I'm really glad that we're committed to using AI responsibly, like just hearing from the both of you. However, the future of AI is still unfolding and we could see it becoming like more integrated in our daily lives. And one last question before we end. How do you see AI shaping the future?
There's something fresh in my mind, right? Okay. Just at the end of last year, okay, I was the judge of the Prom Royal finale. Various activities on stage ongoing. So the contestants, the three of them, were on stage doing live prompting. But the tasks they are given are non-trivial. Okay, they include like build a chatbot in 8 minutes. Okay, build a website in 10 minutes. And if you compare it to the previous year's Prom Royal, the questions or the tasks were much simpler. Okay, why are we able to do it in a matter of a year to increase the complexity of the task and achieve it on the stage? It's because the quality of the tool has improved. Okay, so as we continue that trajectory, I actually do not know where we will land, okay, at end of this year.
Over the past few years, or even just months or weeks, right, we have seen very, very big improvements to how we use AI tools. I myself have been in projects where we think that, you know, we are using very advanced tools such as retrieval augmented generation. So yeah, this retrieval augmented generation has just been out for maybe like the last year or so. But even now, we are already looking at the new type of retrieval augmented generation using new retrieval methods, such as knowledge graph.
Every other week, we see new models that simply blow the previous leaders out of the water. But one thing for sure is that AI will continue to be an important tool as we strive to make our lives better. I'm hopeful that along the way, someone, it may be us, it may be someone else in the world, we will find the right way to control this new technology and make it serve us well.
It's been great chatting with you guys. Thank you, Ghim Eng. Thank you, James.
Thanks.
We spoke about the fundamental use of AI to boost productivity in the Singapore government. And really, what resonated with me the most was what James shared. It is okay to be skeptical about AI, but instead of being scared, right, maybe we should aim to understand tech a little bit better.
Mm.
And only then, ultimately, can we unleash the full capabilities of AI.
Well, thanks, Ghim Eng and James, for your time today. And it's great to see how Singapore government is leveraging AI both as a general purpose tool as well as making it a national strategic priority.
We have come to the end of this episode. If you are keen to find out more about what we've just discussed, you can check out our website at go.gov.sg/govtechdecoded.
If you enjoyed this episode, do support us by sharing it with others and on social media. If you enjoyed the GovTech Decoded series, let us know if you like the second season. You can also connect with our speakers on their LinkedIn pages and follow GovTech on our social media platforms at go.gov.sg/connectwithgovtech. We'll leave the links in the description. I'm Alicia.
And I'm Andre.
And we'll catch you soon.